mother-in-law said to her, "My daughter, should I not seek rest for you that it may be well with you? Is not Boaz our relative, whose young woman you were? See, he is winnowing barley tonight at the threshing floor. Wash, therefore, and anoint yourself. Put on your cloak and go down to the threshing floor. But do not make yourself known to the man until he has finished eating and drinking. But when he lies down, observe the place where he lies. Then go, uncover his feet, and lie down. And he will tell you what to do." And she replied, "All that you say, I will do." So she went down to the threshing floor and did just as her mother-in-law had commanded her. And when Boaz had eaten and drunk and his heart was merry, he went down to lie down at the end of the heap of grain. Then she came softly and uncovered his feet and lay down. At midnight, the man was startled and turned over, and behold, a woman lay at his feet. He said, "Who are you?" And she answered, "I am Ruth, your servant. Spread your wings over your servant, for you are a redeemer." And he said, "May you be blessed by the Lord, my daughter. You have made this last kindness greater than the first, in that you have not gone after young men, whether poor or rich. And now, my daughter, do not fear. I will do for you all that you ask, for my fellow townsmen know that you are a worthy woman. And now it is true that I am a redeemer, yet there is a redeemer nearer than I. Remain tonight, and in the morning, if he will redeem you, good, let him do it. But if he is not willing to redeem you, then as the Lord lives, I will redeem you. Lie down until the morning." So she lay at his feet until the morning, but arose before one could recognize another. And he said, let it not be known that the woman came to the threshing floor. And he said, "Bring the garment you are wearing and hold it out." So she held it, and he measured out 6 measures of barley and put it on her. And she went into the city, and when she came to her mother-in-law, she said, "How did you fare, my daughter?" Then she told her all the man had done for her, saying, "These 6 measures of barley he gave to me, for he said to me, 'You must not go back empty-handed to your mother-in-law.'" She replied, "Wait, my daughter, until you learn how the matter turns out, for the man will not rest, but will settle the matter today." This is the word of the Lord.
Well, Ruth is a powerful short story, and it is a narrative, it's a story, and I feel like each week I kind of got to keep everyone caught up, so it's kind of like, you know, previously on Ruth, okay? So let me get you caught up to speed on where we stand in this story. Ruth, so powerful, this short story with great themes of peril and loss and grief and difficulty and challenge, and yet the steadfast nature of God's love and redemption and amazing characters in these primary characters. If you remember, Naomi was married to a man named Elimelech, and they were from Bethlehem, which is the southern part of Judah or Israel. And yet, because of a great famine, they had to flee Israel and go to Moab, which is modern-day Jordan. And so they became refugees due to this famine. And like many refugees, you find yourself going from the frying pan to a greater fire. And that's what happened to dear Naomi. She gets there and her husband dies and she becomes a widow. Difficult already, the challenge of being a refugee, and now she is a widow. Her two sons end up marrying Moabite women, which from our ears doesn't sound like a big deal, but that would have been a very difficult thing for an Israelite. This is marrying into someone outside of your faith, and they were They worship pagan gods. So they've married Moabite women, these foreigners, these foreign daughter-in-laws, and then 10 years later, both of her sons die. And so she's a widow. Her daughters-in-law have lost their husbands as well. There are 3 widows in a extremely patriarchal society where women could not own property. They had very little power or rights. And your relationships in life were built on your connection to the men in your life. And so they had no standing and in many sense were destitute. The famine is finally gone and they have to get back to Israel. And she wants to make her way back to her people in Bethlehem. And as she's heading home, she stops and pleads with her 2 daughter-in-laws to go back to their people for protection. It really wasn't a test case. I think people wonder, like, is she testing their faith? And, you know, Ruth passed and Orpah did not. But I don't think that's what was behind that. I think she deeply cares for these 2 and she's concerned for them. If you go back to Bethlehem, you'll be outsiders. And who's going to marry you? You're widows and you're both barren. And she pleads with him. So Orpah does eventually go back, but Ruth won't. She pleads again with Ruth, saying, go back to your people. And she says, no, I will go with you. And wherever you go, I will go. And your people will be my people. I want God's people to be my people. I want the living God to be my God. And where you're buried, I'm going to be buried. And she shows this example of such faithfulness to Naomi, but ultimately to the Lord. She's coming to faith, believing in Naomi's God. So Ruth herself is this spiritual outsider. She's a Moabite. She's a refugee. She's now an outsider coming back to Israel. She is widowed herself. She's barren. And so she comes with Naomi back to Israel. But we find in that passage last week that she has come under the shelter of God. She's gotten to this place where she's coming under the shelter of God's wing. She is finding refuge in the Lord. She's saying to herself, I have a strength because God is my shelter and my refuge, even though she's gone through such difficulty. When they get back to Bethlehem and they get reintroduced to the local folks, Naomi says, don't call me Naomi anymore, which means pleasant. Instead, I want you to call me Mara, which means bitter. Naomi's at a place at this point of the story, at the beginning of the story, of bitterness. She's angry, she's sad, she's depressed, of course, because she's lost her husband, her two sons, and she has gone through so much difficulty. In many ways, she's like a female Job of the Old Testament. She says, call me bitter. Do not call me pleasant. But we see a change of heart beginning to happen in Naomi, and we'll see this today. Last week, we see that when they get there, Ruth immediately goes into action, believing and sheltering herself under God's wing, and she goes to glean in Boaz's field in order to provide for her and Naomi. And gleaning was Israel's welfare system that God had designed in the Old Testament, where the poor, so foreigners, widows, and orphans, could glean or harvest grain from the outside, the outskirts of a field. Landowners were encouraged and commanded to leave this section of their fields unharvested so the poor could gather and glean. And she does that. And in so doing, she meets Boaz, the landowner, who's a relative of Naomi. He is a worthy man, it says in the Old Testament. In the Hebrew, it says halil, which is noble or worthy. He is a good man. He could have put her in great jeopardy. She was in harm's way going to glean and as a foreigner, as an outsider in this field. She doesn't know whether the landowner is a good man or a bad man would take advantage of her. He's an amazing man. And as she steps out in faith, he provides, protects, and praises her even. And we see this beautifully last week. He feeds her, sends her home with leftovers, and she asks, she boldly asks, may I not only glean from the outskirts, can I glean among the very middle of the harvest? And he allows this, he encourages it, and tells her and tells the workers, do not prohibit her from taking the very best of the harvest. And he sends her home with 30 pounds of barley for she and Naomi. And so today, that's where we pick up in the story. We're going to see 3 points. The plan, Naomi's plan for her, the proposal, and then the promise. The plan, the proposal, and the promise. First, the plan. In verse 1 of our chapter this morning, we see Naomi, which means pleasant, stopping being Mara. She's saying, you know, I've asked everyone to call me Mara, but I think she's returning to be Naomi again. Because her focus is no longer like on her suffering. She begins to say to her daughter-in-law, she starts caring for her. She says, should I not seek rest for you so that it may go well with you? Her focus is now on Ruth and providing for Ruth. She wants to make a match between Ruth and Boaz. Part of it probably was for self-protection because they were in a destitute place and the harvest is coming to an end. She's probably feeling like, man, we're running out of time, and there needs to be a connection between Boaz and Ruth. But she cares for Ruth in a way that we've not seen quite as clearly before today. Her heart is warming by God's chesed, his faithfulness. She's beginning to see it more and more. She wants Ruth to go to Boaz at the threshing floor. What is a threshing floor? So a threshing floor was a place in these towns, and every town would have one, where after landowners would have their grain harvested, you would take the grain to the threshing floor, which would be a large area, which would either be like stone or hard path ground, where you could take your grain and thresh it. You would beat it, pound it, removing the husk or the kernel, or excuse me, the outer shell, the light husk and so forth from the kernel of grain itself. You would beat it, pound it, and then it would usually be at a place in town, like on a hill or an elevated place where there'd be a little bit more breeze or wind, and then they would kind of throw the grain up in the air, and the wind and the breeze would separate the chaff from the wheat. And then they'd keep the wheat, the grain, they'd gather it, they'd harvest it, and it'd be a time of celebration. You wouldn't be the only one at the threshing floor. This would be like a communal event where the town, the landowners would gather and they would harvest their grain together. There would be meals and celebration, and it would be a celebration of the end of the harvest if it was a good one. This one was a great time of praise and celebration because it's when the famine is coming to an end. There's a harvest. There's celebration. And so she says, I want you to go to the threshing floor. And she has this very practical bit of advice for Ruth as she goes. Now, first of all, I want you to know this. Character is far more important than looks, but physical attraction is important when it comes to romance. We know that. You have to be physically attracted to someone that you're going to marry and love. And so she gives her these six practical advice things. First, she says, bathe. You've been working in the field. Bathe. Second, anoint yourself. Perfume, scented oils, that kind of thing. And third, put your cloak on, meaning you don't need to mourn anymore. Put on a nice dress. Now, the first three kind of remind me of the basic advice that I tried to impress upon my boys throughout their entire teenage years. Number one, would you please take a shower? I did, Dad. Yeah, but when? Like 2 days ago, I'm fine. Like, no, like you're never going to be married. I'll never have grandkids. Like, two, would you please put on some deodorant, man? Like, I don't smell. Trust me, dude, like, put on deodorant. And third, can you dress a little better, dude? Like, come on. Anyway, we have these conversations. My mom once asked my boys, does anyone ever ask you if you're homeless? Why? Why, Nani? Because you dress like you're homeless. Okay, so those three things. Practical advice, if you're a young person that ever wants to get married, especially young men, follow those three things. You'll do real well. Okay, but fourth, she says this, don't go to Boaz until after he's had his meal and has had some drink and is full. Wait until that time. And fifth, observe where he lies down. Yeah, don't go to someone else. Okay, make sure. It's a large threshing floor. Lots of people would be there laying with their grain. It's dark. So she's literally very practical. Make sure you're going to him, not someone else. And six, and the most confusing one is this, uncover his feet. Lay at his feet, and he will tell you what to do. The plan. So Ruth goes, and she implements the plan. But now we see something different than the plan. We see the proposal. We aren't exactly sure why she's supposed to uncover her feet. It may have been a cultural thing, like, hey, instead of writing you a note, or I like you, or, you know, texting, you know, like, I'm just going to uncover your feet, and then that's supposed to be like, hey, I like you, you know. We don't know. It just sounds annoying to me, and it kind of feels like what our dog does to us every night. Gets in bed with us, knocks our covers off, and then lays at our feet, right? So, but instead, this is what she does. She goes to him. She uncovers his blanket from his feet. He's all tucked in. He's had a good meal, good drink. He's sound asleep. It's midnight, and all of a sudden, he feels his feet cold. It's windy, and he's cold. So he wakes up, and he says, who are you? Recognizing that there's somebody at his feet, and she says, it's Ruth, your servant. And she's followed the plan exactly up to this point, but now she deviates from Naomi's plan because she goes into action, and she says, redeem me. She says it specifically this way, spread your wings over your servant, for you are a redeemer, a goel. And the word for wings here can also be translated as covering or cloak. Now, at prima facie, this sounds a little lurid, but it's not. She's not doing anything inappropriate. She's saying, redeem me, marry me. You are a kinsman redeemer. Redeem me. and marry me." Now, Boaz was a kinsman redeemer. He's been called that multiple times in the passage. So let's talk about what that means for a little bit. In Leviticus 25, God made an appropriation for widows. So if your brother was married and died, your brother dies and was left with a widow, and you're another man, you were to marry his wife. I know it sounds strange to us. This isn't a romance thing. It is a protection of a widow who would be destitute and be put in harm's way. This is to provide for her financially, to give her a name, to protect her and her children, that any harm might come to her. So to us, it's so strange sounding, but women had no rights or property or power, and this was a way to protect someone who would be on the margins of society without it. So a redeemer, this is called the Levirate law. In Leviticus 25, it's something different to be a redeemer. I switched the two, so let me back up for a second. Here's what a redeemer was. If somebody got indebted and they were having to sell their land, their property, the closest relative to them was supposed to redeem them by buying the land. This is found in Leviticus 25. So he is to buy the land from the person that is indebted. She is appealing to this law. Redeem the land. Redeem Naomi's land. But here's the problem. It wasn't Naomi's land. It was Elimelech's. And then it would go to her sons. But her sons died, right? So Naomi and Elimelech are married. They own land. Well, why did they leave if they own land? Well, there was a famine. And the land wasn't producing any food, so they went to Moab. But now they're back. And she owns the land, but she doesn't really, because she's a woman. And there's no male to own the land. And so what Ruth is appealing to is something that went way beyond the letter of the law. It was the spirit of the law. Boaz was a redeemer, but way down the line. He's not Elimelech's brother or uncle. He's further down the line. He would actually have no legal obligation to redeem the land. And by the way, women can't own land anyway. And so she's like pressing into the spirit of the law. Next, she appeals to this Levirate law, which was this. If a close relative died, you were to marry, you know, your brother died and was left with a widow, you were to marry that widow. Well, this would be regards to Naomi, not Ruth. And once again, Boaz is not Elimelech's brother. And so letter of the law, he would not be required, according to the Old Testament, to marry her, but she appeals to him anyway on this basis of the spirit of the law in both cases. And there, a common refrain throughout Ruth is this appeal to the spirit of the law instead of the letter of the law. The spirit of the law would be to leave a little bit of grain on the edge of your field, the letter of the law. The spirit of the law, though, is feed the poor, and Boaz does that. Again, Ruth isn't sitting by passively, but stepping out in faith and pressing into the spirit of God's law and trusting him by faith. So beautiful. Tony Morita is an author who wrote a commentary on Ruth that I'm reading. And he says this, "Once again, we see that even though the book of Ruth highlights the providence of God, the characters do not slip into passive fatalism. They are active, not disengaged. They do not say, 'God is sovereign, so let's just wait until a husband knocks on the door.' God's sovereignty is not a license for inactivity." And so throughout Ruth, we've been talking about how we live under the faithfulness of God, his sovereignty. When you're God's child by faith and you have a decision to make in life, there's a temptation to be passive and to say, "I don't know God's will. I don't know what to do. I'm just going to wait and pray and pray." And certainly you should pray over all things. But there's a freedom that the child of God ought to enjoy, which is this. You're a child of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. His Bible is his moral will for our lives. He's given us his word to know how to live, and we should live our lives according to his word. But the Bible doesn't give us the details of where to move or what job to take or when to do this or that or marry this person, not that person. And you have to step out by faith. And that God's will is often, if you are seeking to live your life for God and to walk in his ways, seek first the kingdom of God and all these things will be added unto you. As you're seeking to live that way and you step out into life and keep walking forward, God's will begins to get more and more revealed in its details. She steps out into faith and action. And what great faith she has. She takes these huge risks. She does something unbelievable. She appeals to Boaz to redeem the land and to marry her. And what man would do that? The servant is asking the boss to marry her. The Moabite, the outsider, is appealing to the Israelite to marry her. The younger is asking the older. The poor person with no resources appeals to the one with all the resources. Marry me. The woman is asking the man. That doesn't even happen today, does it? I mean, not very often at least. How will he respond? How will Boaz respond? He could have been angry for waking him up. What are you doing? I was sound asleep, man. He could have been offended. How dare you propose to me? I am the redeemer. I am the kinsman redeemer. I am older than you. I am the landowner. I am the boss. I am the man. This is my job. He could have taken advantage of her right then and right there as she's being vulnerable. But instead, he's honored and he blesses her. He says this, and now we come to the promise, which is the third point. He's blessing her yet again. He says in verse 10, "May you be blessed by the Lord, my daughter. You have made this last kindness greater than the first, in that you have not gone after young men, whether poor or rich." And when he says this phrase, "this last kindness greater than the first," the word for kindness is the Hebrew word hesed, which we've been talking about throughout the book of Ruth, is God's steadfast, covenantal love, and it's the kind of love that God calls his people to. In English, we try to describe it, and throughout seminary, I had this one professor, and she was from Australia, and she said the word hesed probably 25 times in every lecture in this very British hesed, she would say, like, over and over, hesed, hesed, hesed. And I'm like, what? This woman only has one theme in her teaching. It's like, because it's so pervasive in the Old Testament. And it's God's steadfast covenantal love, the one that he never gives up on, that he is this covenant keeper and so forth. And it's just so repeated throughout. Loyalty. In English, we try to describe it. Loyalty, kindness, steadfast love, covenantal love. None of them do justice to what it means in the original. And essentially, it's kind of like when God calls us, "You shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbors yourself." That's steadfast love. It's what we're called to do, and yet what is impossible for us to do. It's the very thing by which we need a Savior, because we look and go, who can do that? Love God with all of our being? Man, I try, but I've never lived one day like that. Love my neighbor as much as I love myself. Try to seek their flourishing as much as I seek my own. Really? And yet we see in that call, steadfast love has said, and we see that only fully and finally do we find that in Yahweh, in the complete picture in Jesus himself. Right? God's steadfast love, his loyalty to us. But we also see it beautifully in Ruth. She uniquely, and Boaz too, are showing us what it means to be a person of God, to walk with God humbly and to be a person of hesed, always a person that will never be perfect in this life, but look at how what faithfulness looks like. She, loyal kindness to Naomi and to Boaz, and Boaz to her. Ruth 3, verse 11, he says this, "Now, my daughter, do not fear. I will do for you all that you ask, for my fellow townsmen know that you are a worthy woman." And that word worthy is hayil in Hebrew, and it's the same word that the narrator describes Boaz in the opening when we're introduced to him in the book. Worthy, he's a worthy man, he's a noble man. He says the entire town knows that you are worthy. Look at Boaz's kindness. He tells her, "Don't fear. I'm going to do this. I'm going to redeem you. You're worthy. Everyone in town knows that you are a worthy woman, even though she's a Moabite, even though she's an outsider, even though she's barren. The worst thing for a woman in this culture, even though she's a widow. And he makes this promise, but there's a twist in the promise, in the plot. There's a problem. Dun, 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 dun. There is a nearer redeemer. There's a greater redeemer. There's somebody that's closer than Boaz in relationship, maybe with more power and influence, but somebody that's a closer relative to Elimelech and Naomi. But he says this, I will go to him. I will take action on this. I will ask him, do you want to redeem the land? And then he says, and by the way, if you redeem the land, you got to marry Ruth. But wait for that next week. Make sure you turn in. Same bat channel, same time next week. Now, let's look at this. After this, Ruth remained at his feet until the early morning, and then he wakes, has her go before everyone else gets up. He is concerned for her reputation, but he doesn't leave her empty-handed yet again. He has her take her garment, and he gives her 60 to 90 pounds of grain. Now, I'm assuming that they don't live right next door to the threshing floor, so Ruth is strong, okay? Have you ever carried 60 to 90 pounds around? I have. I do it all the time, just for fun. And just kidding, not really. But that's a lot of weight. So Ruth is into CrossFit or something because she carries 60 to 90 pounds back to her house. I love that Ruth goes to Boaz. She follows the instructions perfectly, but she adds one more thing. She's supposed to wait. She says, wait it. His feet, Naomi says, and he will tell you what to do. But in this is the Old Testament. This is thousands of years ago. In an extremely patriarchal culture, the hero of the story and the great, 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 great grandmother of Jesus, she steps up and said to Boaz, redeem me. Redeem the land and marry me. Naomi and Ruth are desperate. They need redemption. They're going to starve. They're going to be indebted. And if you're indebted in this culture, you will be enslaved. If you have nothing to give, no money, whatever, what happens is you become somebody's slave, their servant. You will have to serve them until your debt is worked off. Naomi, this is what Naomi and Ruth are facing. They're going to be in debt. If they aren't already, and they will be enslaved. And she says, buy the land, redeem us. Redemption is what she's calling for. They're desperate for it. And dear friends, I don't care who you are, every one of us in this room is in desperate need of redemption. And the words debt and slavery are a perfect description of what we deal with in our hearts. Debt and slavery are perfect examples of what sin does to us. We have a debt between us and God, an enormous one, because of our sin. Every one of us is building a life apart from God. We're saying, I will be the Lord of my life, and it puts a debt between us and God. Tim Keller, in an article called Serving Each Other Through Forgiveness, says this, in every case when wrong is done, there is a debt. And there's no way to deal with it without suffering. Either you make the perpetrator suffer for it, or you forgive and suffer for it yourself. Forgiveness is always expensive. It's costly. It is emotionally costly. When you forgive, what you're doing is paying the debt yourself. When we pray the Lord's Prayer, we either say, forgive us our trespasses, right, as we trespass against. Maybe I said that wrong. You get the idea. Or we say, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. We recognize that we have a debt between one another as people, and we don't like to think of it in terms of our relationship with God. We kind of say to ourselves, like, why would we be indebted to God? Why would he even care what we do down here? If he's so powerful, so sovereign, altogether holy and so righteous and so big, and he created the universe after all, why would he care about what we do? And why would he take it personally? Why, if we do something wrong, why would that create a debt between us and God? Let me make this case to you why I think this is so and why I think the Bible describes it this way. It's because of this. We were created in God's image. We were created to be rightly related to him, to love him, to fellowship him, to walk with him. But we have been rebellion against him our entire existence. Since Genesis 3, every human being, there's a rebellion between us and God saying, I will live my life for myself. And once again, you could say, well, who cares? You know, why does he even care about that? Well, if it's true among us, like we are created in his image as relational creatures, and if we create debts between one another as we hurt each other, and let's trust it, we know that's true. We know how costly it is when somebody harms you, hurts you, abuses you, does some awful thing to you. It takes something from you. They are indebted to you. And if you're going to forgive them, it's costly. Every time you want to gossip about them and you don't, you pay the price. Every time you want to punch them in the face and you don't, you're paying the price. Every time you could run them down to your children and you choose not to instead so that they think better of your ex-husband or whatever, the person that's done you wrong, and you don't, you're paying off the debt. You're paying it down. You're absorbing it yourself. You're saying, I will pay the debt rather than inflict pain on the other. Forgiveness is costly. If that's true between us as humans, and we're created in his image, why do we seem so offended by that being a reality between us and God? There is a debt between us and God. And we're enslaved to sin. We're enslaved. They faced debt, indebtedness and slavery. We are indebted to God, and in a sense, we are enslaved to our very sin. If you don't think you're enslaved to your sin and are sort of addicted to it, try not sinning for a while. Okay? Not the letter of the law, you shall not commit adultery. But Jesus says, what about the spirit of the law? If you even lust after your neighbor's wife, you've committed adultery. Not just the letter of the law, you shall not murder, but Jesus' spirit of the law, where he says, if you have been angry with your brother and called him a fool, who hasn't done that, then you have a heart of murder. Get up tomorrow and say, all right, I'm going to live in such a way that I don't live for myself all day long. I'm going to love my neighbor as much as I love myself. Try to do that for one day. And as you do, you will see the ways in which your heart is enslaved to selfishness, which is the heart of sin. And yet, the gospel is that we're redeemed. We're redeemed. Someone has paid the debt and freed us from slavery. I love Ruth's boldness in saying, buy the land, marry me, and redeem us. What boldness. Our problem isn't just that we've sinned, but we're slaves to sin. And I love that Ruth has this beautiful boldness. Boaz was willing to pay the price for redemption. And I've got such great news for you, friends. He appeals like, there's this nearer redeemer. There's this greater redeemer ahead of you. And I know in context, he doesn't mean Jesus, but I can't help as a gospel preacher to go, there is a greater redeemer. There is a nearer redeemer, a better redeemer. It's Jesus. In Ephesians 1:7, it says this, in him we have redemption through his blood, payment, paying the debt through his blood for the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace. This part moves my heart so much of the story. Why would Ruth be so bold as to say, redeem us, and to press into the spirit of the law like Jesus does? Why would she have such boldness to go to this man, this powerful man, all the resources, he has all the power, he's the man, she's not, he's an Israelite, he's the landowner. Why would she be so bold to say, Do it, Boaz. Redeem me. Marry me. Because she knew his heart. He had shown what a faithful man, what a worthy man, and what a good man he was, what a gracious and steadfast, loving man he was. She got a sense of who he was. She had such boldness because she's bold. Let's face it. She's bold. Go home, go home to your people, Ruth. And she's like, no, my people, your God, my God. I'm going with you. I'm going to die with you. I'm going to be buried with you. That's boldness. But it wasn't strictly boldness that led her to be so bold with Boaz. It was because she knew that the heart of Boaz would receive her. And Boaz, in his response to Ruth, I think ultimately points us to Jesus and his heart towards you, towards sinners like me and you. It says in Hebrews 4, we do not have a high priest who's unable to sympathize with us in our weakness, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are and yet without sin. And this is the point I want us to see. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace and help in time of need. You can boldly go to Jesus and say, redeem me. That's what the gospel is, friends. Some of you have never done that, and here's the deal. I don't care what you've done, how far away from God you've been, how enslaved to sin you've been, how big the debt is, doesn't matter. Is not God glorified when he cancels all of our debts from the greatest to the smallest? And by the way, every one of our debts is an infinite debt anyway. It's just, he is glorified. He loves to redeem. Do you get the sense like Boaz is now like, oh, okay, I guess I'll do it. He's like, I will do it. I want to do it. He loves her. God loves to redeem the lost. God loves to redeem those who are broken and contrite before him and humble before him and say, redeem me, please. I need redemption. It's that bad. I don't come to you because I'm so good. I come to you because I'm that desperate. I am enslaved. I am indebted. I need redemption. You have to have that humility to come. You can't have it. You can't get redemption without that humility. But I promise you this, the Lord Jesus always receives anyone who comes with that humility saying, please redeem me. I may not deserve it, but I need it. Please redeem. And yet, some of you have never done that and need to. And today, even in today, if you do that, the Lord will redeem you. But some of you have done that, and yet you still doubt. Just this week, I've had conversations with people that are saying, I don't know. I don't know. I don't know if I can have confidence that I've been forgiven. I, for this reason or that reason, I feel like I'm in, I'm out, I'm in, I'm out. That's not how the gospel works, dear friends. You're redeemed. Why? Steadfast love, chesed. God never gives up on his steadfast love, his loving kindness, his faithfulness, his covenantal love. He never gives up on that. Our relationship with him is not in and out of his grace. And I also have another good word for you. Without Christ, of course, we're not worthy, but in Jesus Christ, we become his worthy children, his daughters, his sons. Isn't that beautiful? Ruth, he says, you're worthy. And many, from the world's perspective, Ruth was not worthy. How do women in that culture get worthy? They have to have boys, not just girls. Girls didn't mean anything. You had to produce a male heir. Then you had worth. Then you were worthy. You had to have a husband. She was a widow. She was barren. She had no money. She is an outsider. She's not even from Israel. She's not worthy according to that culture. But by grace in her own heart and character, she is called worthy. You and I, friends, in our own, we're not worthy. But the good news of this is when you become a follower of Jesus, when you look to him by faith, you're not only forgiven, you're counted as a son and daughter. And he then says, you're righteous. You're justified by grace through faith alone. You're righteous. And I'm going to make you more righteous. I'm going to make you my own, but I call you worthy. You're mine. Would you be bold enough to believe that this week? In spite of your weakness, in spite of your sin, in spite of the difficulty in your life and the circumstances of your life, would you rest in the fact that God has set upon you his covenantal love, his steadfast love, and he says to you, you're mine. You're my dear child. I love you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this great story in your word, this beautiful story of Naomi, who we are seeing her heart warm to you again because you are so faithful to her, even though the circumstances of her life were abysmal, that you are redeeming her story and she will be pleasant again. We thank you for Ruth, the friend of friends. And we thank you for Boaz and his faithfulness. But above all, we thank you to Jesus, to whom shines over this entire story. Thank you that there is a Redeemer, a greater Redeemer, a near Redeemer, an ultimate Redeemer in Christ. And would we be so bold, like Ruth, to claim those promises, to lean into those, to believe them, that they're true for us? We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. We come today, friends,